Welcome to this presentation about object-oriented development in Ferdi. Let's start with two additions we made recently in the Ferdi language to make sure you didn't miss them. The first one is a C variant. C variant is a way for you to declare your variables so that they can accept any kind of values. This possibility was until now reserved to Ferdi commands. But now you can have your own project methods with parameters accepting any kind of values. Let's say, for example, that you would like your customized version of the collection.push method. You want a collection.push that will silently ignore null values. And for when attempting to push a text, it will push the uppercase version of the text and call the regular version of the push command for any other kind of values. So here you would write this kind of project method, declaring $2 as a C variant and case of, depending on the value or the value type of $2, you would do anything you want according to the value being passed. When you use this kind of code, you have a collection, you have your own version of the push command, your own method, and you can call your method passing it a number, a text, or attempting to pass a null value. The second thing, important thing we added to the Ferdi language are formula. Formula is a new kind of object which encapsulate a single line of Ferdi code, and this Ferdi code is able to access the properties of the object on which the formula has been applied. Here, for example, I have a person object with the first name and the last name, and I have a say property of kind of formula, and this formula calls the alert command to display the first name and last name of my person. When I call my say formula, I use the traditional parenthesis syntax, and I can even pass an additional value. Here I pass the string hello, so that my formula can access simultaneously parameters I pass at the time I call the formula and the properties of the object on which I applied my formula. So this is important because I can not only have an object which defines the properties of the object, but also the behavior, the way to deal with these properties. For example, if I change the properties first name and last name, I can also change the say command to adapt to the properties of the object, so I can change the behavior of the object according to the data. Now, classes. Classes are a very important evolution in the Ferdi language. It is a natural evolution of object, and I think the best way to explain classes are first with a demo in the Ferdi code editor and Ferdi debugger. So let's start the demo. So let me show you how classes work in Ferdi. I'm creating a new project database because classes are only available in project mode. In the Explorer, you have a new item, classes, that will show you all your classes in your database. You create a new class exactly the same way as you would create a new project method, specifying its name and choosing an Explorer folder to organize your classes. The code editor opens your class, and then here you can define all your functions, all your class functions. With a new keyword function, you can specify the name of a class function. So here I am typing the code of my class function myAlert, and I can this way define several functions as many as I want. So here I have in my class person two functions, myAlert and myAlert2. I create a new project method to use this class. So how do I use my class? Initializing an object variable. So I am accessing my class from my class store. The CS command is a new command that gives you access to the class store, all the catalog of all your classes in your database. You have inside your class store, now you have the class person. From this class, you can create a new object with the new function. Once you get an object of one class, you can call your class functions on this object. I have myAlert and myAlert2. I can try it in the debugger. So myAlert, I am stepping inside myAlert. So I can see that I am inside the code of myAlert function. I can see only the code of the myAlert function. Stepping out, entering myAlert2. Here I am inside myAlert2. I see only the code of myAlert2. And it has been executed successfully. And I am exiting. So now I have my code which instantiates a class object. I have my class person. What is a class? Actually, a class is stored as one individual file. All your functions of one class are inside one single file. Let's look in the Finder at how it is organized. The source folder. In the source folder, you can recognize the methods folder to store all your project methods. And next to it, and you now have the classes subfolder. You can see that the class person we just created is here. The name of the class is the name of the file. Let's say I duplicate my file in the Finder. So I have a new file, person copy. If I switch back to 4D, automatically 4D recognized there is a new class and it is instantly available. We can see here in the Explorer that for each class, you see the individual function of each class in the preview pane. From 4D, if you rename a class, let's say I'm renaming it person copy to person2, for example, you can see that in the Finder, the file has been renamed as well to person2. If from the Finder I am trashing one class, when I get back to 4D, the class has disappeared as well in 4D. So one class is a file. In a class, you have all your functions. Let's say I am trying to type the code of an already existing function. Here, the code editor detects automatically that you have a duplicate. You cannot have two functions with the same name in the same class. Each function can be collapsed. So you can see only the function code that you want. And the end of a function is the start of the next one. There is no special keyword. to designate the end of a function. So I have the class person. Now I want to define some useful function for this class person. So for example, I want to define the name of my person. So each function may have, of course, parameters. Let's say I am passing $1 and $2 to initialize the first name and the last name of my object. The object on which a function is applied is accessible using the this command. So I am initializing my first name and the last name with $2. Similarly, I am defining who am I function that will reply with the name, the full name of the person. I am modifying my code here, so I am setting the name of my object, for example, John Smith, and calling who am I on this object. So if I am executing this code in the debugger, entering set name, so here I am accessing my object, so this is the object applied on which set name has been applied, initializing first name and last name. So I can see that $O is actually the same object written by the this command inside set name. Entering who am I? In who am I am accessing the same this object to return the full name. So my full name is John Space Smith. So now what I would like to do is to make the code more elegant and to set the name at the time I create the object. What I want to do is this, to not be forced to have two lines of code to create an object with all the properties. This is possible by using what we call a constructor. The constructor function is a special function . It has no name, it is implicit. It is a function, a regular function like any other, but the name is implicit, it is the constructor function of the class. So my constructor will receive the first name and the last name. So here I could copy-paste the initializing of first name and last name. But what is more convenient is to reuse the setName function. So I want to apply the setName function, passing it the same $1 and $2. So here, actually, I am forwarding $1 and $2 to my existing function to initialize first name and last name. Let's try the code at the beginning. So I am creating the object and calling the constructor in one line. So I am stepping inside. So here you see that I am inside the constructor function of my class person, stepping inside the set name. So here the constructor is calling set name, initializing first name and last name, getting out, and then the who am I function will behave just like before with no change. So Now I have my class person with my constructor, two functions. Now what I would like to do is to create a new class which will inherit the behavior of this class person, but with adding new functionalities. For example, I want to create a new class student for a category of person who are studying at school. So I want to inherit the same function as setName and whoAmI. The student has the first name, has the last name, so I want to reuse the same behavior. So I am using a new keyword, class extends, to say that a student is actually a person. By writing this line of code, I'm saying that I want the class student to inherit all the behavior of the class person. But I want a specific constructor, because a student has a first name, a last name, and an additional property, which is the school where the student is studying. So the same first name and last name, and the third parameter for the school. Here I want to initialize student as a person. So I want to call the constructor of the person class. To do that, there is a new command, super designate the super class. The super class for student is the class person. So here, by writing this, I am asking to call the constructor of the super class, passing it first name and last name. Then I can complete the constructor of the student class by initializing the school property with $3. And I can also add an additional function available only for students, for example, getSchool. So now that I have the class student, I can use it. Okay, so in my class store, now I have a new class student. I will set another name, for example, James Bond. Yes, he was studying. And I can ask the school. But I forgot to specify the third parameter for the constructor of a student, which is the school. So, for example, okay, studying at school, high school. So let's execute this code to know what is happening. Entering the new student. So here you can see that we are inside the constructor function of the student class. Stepping in, so I am entering the call of the super class constructor. Here we are inside the constructor of the person class, which is the super class of student. Setting the name, so now I am inside set name of the person class. Getting out, get back to the student constructor to complete the construction of my student with the school parameter. So now, because it is a student, it has the getSchool function to return the school, and the whoAmI function, which has been inherited from the person class. So this is the code of the whoAmI function of the person class. That's nice, but now I would like to customize the whoAmI function to take into account the fact that this person is actually a student. So what I can do is to override the method who am I. I am redefining it. Here, I want the who am I function of the class person is returning first name and last name. I just want to add something more. So what I want to do is to call the who am I function of my superclass. So this is the syntax. This is another way to use the super command to access a function of a superclass. This will return last name, first name, space, and last name. So I will add some string. Of the school of the student. Get back to my project method. Let's see the who am I function. I didn't change the code of my calling code, but when I get inside, now I am inside the who am I function of my student. I'm no longer inside the who am I function of person. But from student who am I am calling, explicitly calling the person who am I function to provide first name and last name and adding some more information. So the result is now first name, last name and the school. That's nice. So what is important to notice here in the class student, you remember in the class student, we called the constructor of my superclass. Then I set the school parameter. Maybe I know that my person constructor is actually calling set name to pass first name and last name. So another way to do that would have been to call directly this set name $1 and $2. Let's see what will happen if I'm trying to do this. Creating student new, calling the constructor. Ah, there is an error. Can't use this before superclass has been constructed. Why? Because at this point, because you didn't call the constructor of the superclass, it is your responsibility to call it, and it has not been called, so it is not yet a person. Until the constructor of person has been called. So you cannot call anything related to the person class until you call explicitly the constructor of the person class. That's why the this command is illegal until you call with the super command the constructor of your super class. This is very important to remember. So I fix my code. This is the proper way to initialize it. For the same reason, initializing school, you must initialize the school after calling the constructor of the superclass. You cannot do it this way because here, remember, this command triggers an error until you call explicitly the constructor of the superclass here. So you must initialize, you must use this after the call of the superclass constructor. Okay. No, I have two classes, person and student, a method which create two objects from different classes. What is nice, it integrates very well with all other parts of 4D, for example, in a form. So I can create a project form to display my object. So I will create a list box, configure to use a collection to, for example, to display my collection persons from my form object. And I will initialize in a button my persons collection. So I have the code that creates the two objects here. Building my collection, pushing my two people. In my form, I just have to configure my column to display this. Who am I? So here I am saying that in my list box, in the first column, I want to display the result of the who am I function of each object of my list box. Resizing my column, running my form, initializing my collection. And you can see that I can see my two people. For the first one is a student, so it called the who am I function of the student class. And the second one is not a student, it is a regular person, and it's calling the who am I function of my person class. As you can see, the classes is a way to modularize your code, your object, and to encapsulate the behavior cleanly in each individual class. You can reuse and extend the behavior of one class in another, and make the code that will use your classes very elegant and as small as possible, hiding the complexity in your class's code. Thank you. So, as you have seen in the demonstration, classes are a set of functions which define the behavior of all the objects of one particular class. A class can extend another class, which is named its super class, to add more functions or to override existing ones. All the functions available on a particular class is called its prototype. A typical anatomy of a class. In the same file, you can have one single, it's optional, one single statement class extends to declare the parent class of a class. It is optional. By default, a class is extending the built-in object class. Also optional is the class constructor function. So the class constructor functions is called implicitly by 4D when you instantiate an object of a particular class. You must call the constructor of the parent class if it has one. Then in a class, you have as many functions as you want, and a function may be overriding an existing function on of a superclass. In that case, we say that this function is overriding a function of its superclass. All the classes in a database form the class store. The class store is accessible using the new CS command, the CS for class store. The class store returns the catalog of all the classes of a database or any component or database has its own class store. 4D, 4D is a new command named 4D, which returns the class store of built-in classes in 4D. For example, the file class or the folder class are built-in classes which are not dependent on a specific database, so they are accessible in a specific class store. If a component wants to expose its own classes to other database, it can simply share its class store by returning its own CS in using a shared project method with a single line of code, $0 equal CS. In that way, any database calling its project method will have access to the class store of a component and then will be able to instantiate object of a class of a component. Obinstanceof is a new command in the 4D language that lets you know at runtime if one specific object is an instance of a class of any subclass of this class. For example, with a person student example we have seen, if you have an object, you can know if an object is a person or a student, because a student is a person. You can also test if an object is a file object or a folder object or any built-in class used by 4D. ObiClass. ObiClass is also a new command in the 4D language. ObiClass, you pass it an object and it returns the class this object belongs to. So it's very simple. It's here for to diagnose, to understand your code. So here, for example, in the screenshot, you can see the what the debugger is displaying for a particular object. For example, a student. You can see that a class object as a name property and the superclass property, and from the superclass property you can access to the class object of the parent class if any. That way you have the full hierarchy of classes of your object. You noticed that there is also a locker ID property. That means that a class object is actually a shared object. This is because class objects are shared among all your 4D processes. This is a unique object shared by all your objects using the same class. And this particularity can be used to store properties you want to be common to all your objects of the same class. For example, say in your student class, you want to keep the collection of all possible universities, for example. So you want one shared collection used by all the students instance of the same class student. Because cs.student, which is a student class object, is shared, you can use it to store your own properties. So here in this example, I use the use statement to add my own university's property as a shared collection. So this is done at init time at the startup of your database, for example. Then in a function of your class, you can access to your shared object using the hobby class you apply to the this object. Then that way you access to your shared object shared among all your processes and all the instances of your class. And then you can check, for example, here I am checking if the school of the student is among the known universities I have initialized at the beginning of my database. That's it. This was a presentation about 4D classes, and I hope you appreciate it. The introduction of classes marks the start of a great evolution in the 4D language. More will come gradually, with each feature release, taking into account your feedback. Thank you.